He just reminded me, this is the 300th episode of the podcast. Wow. So we've created really starting, I guess, January 11th, it was last year, 300 hours roughly of content. And I hope you've enjoyed it. It's been a great journey. And so, you know, there's no time to celebrate. On we go to 400 and onward. I want to talk here about the left's really pathetic attempt to get Thomas, Justice Thomas, to recuse himself, maybe even step down. He should resign. And why should he resign? Not because of anything he's done, evidently, but because of some emails and some political activism on the part of his wife. This is Ginni Thomas, by the way, a friend of mine. I've known both Thomases now for several years. In fact, I was kind of buddies with Clarence Thomas back in his old days at the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission. We had lunch a few times. I just loved to hear his booming laugh, and I just enjoyed his perspective on issues. Now, this is a guy who's really not just a great justice, but he's been a great human being, and somebody who has withstood unbelievable attacks from the left, and they've never let up. They, of all the justices, this is the guy that they can't stand. And by the way, this really dismantles all their rhetoric of race. You know, oh, we got to have the first black woman in the Supreme Court. Well, you've had a black justice on the Supreme Court, and how have you treated him over the past decades? So the latest ruse or pretext to go after him is Ginni Thomas. And what are Ginni Thomas's great offense? Well, apparently she was part of the group that believed, didn't believe the results of the election. She was apparently sending texts to Mark Meadows, the White House chief of staff, saying that there are different ways in which Trump could challenge the results. Anyway, putting all that to the side, who cares? There's a big difference between what Ginni Thomas is doing. Now, if Clarence Thomas was doing all that, you could say, well, wait a minute, he's supposed to be on the court. These are cases that could come before the court. He has somehow taken a political position or compromised his objectivity as a judge. But none of that is even at issue. The issue is, should Thomas recuse himself from cases or should he step down because of his wife's email activism? Now, by the way, Ginni Thomas didn't organize events of January 6th or anything like that. So any suggestion to the contrary has no support at all. But the point is this, that there is a kind of well-established standard for when judges have to recuse themselves from cases. And the standard is this, they have to do it when they have a financial conflict of interest. So a judge has a lot of his investments in Company A. Company A is suing Company B. They're coming before the court. Yeah, that's a case where the judge has a clear interest, a financial interest. And or when the judge has, there's some obvious reason to question the judge's impartiality. An example has actually come up in connection with Ketanji Jackson. But just think, for example, about a judge that served on the Harvard Board of Trustees and has been, in a sense, very active in the administration of Harvard University. Now there's a lawsuit over Harvard's affirmative action program. The judge would obviously, in a sense, tend to side with Harvard because they've got, he or she has got a long-standing relationship with the university. So there's a question of impartiality. So those are cases where judges recuse themselves. But let's remember that most judges, and this applies to appellate court judges, district court judges, Supreme Court judges, they're married to influential people. And these influential people do all kinds of things. And in some cases, these influential people are in the law. They're in the legal field. They file legal briefs, and they file legal briefs in some cases that are cited in Supreme Court rulings. But in all these cases, we find case after case where judges do not step down, are not required to step down, and ethics reviews of their conduct show that they did not have to step down. Here's an example. Here's Ninth Circuit Court Judge Stephen Reinhardt of the Ninth Circuit. This, by the way, is a kind of a liberal icon. And a case was making its way up to his court. And his wife, who was the head of an ACLU chapter, had commented on the lower court opinion. And the ACLU submitted a brief to the court, so you'd think that Judge Reinhardt would be like, well, maybe I should step down, my wife is involved, the ACLU is involved. But Reinhardt goes, quote, that his wife's views are, quote, hers, not mine, and I do not in any way condition my opinions on the position she takes regarding any issues. So basically what Reinhardt is saying is, I'm my own man, and the fact that my wife is a public figure and the fact that she has opinions doesn't make them my opinions. So You know, there appears to be here on the part of the left a kind of resurrection of the old standard that wives sort of don't have positions of their own. Their positions are a kind of annex or extension of their husband's. And therefore, Ginni Thomas's activism is now sort of automatically attributed to Clarence Thomas. Ruth Bader Ginsburg. Her husband, Marty Ginsburg, was a prominent figure in a law firm. That law firm represented parties before the Supreme Court. In no case did Justice Ginsburg recuse herself. In fact, even her daughter, Jane Ginsburg, is a law professor, and she's wrote articles about cases coming before the court. Justice Ginsburg, in one case, voted for the result that her daughter advocated in an article. Nobody said there was anything improper about this. Why? Because that's Justice Ginsburg's opinions, which are separate from the opinions of her husband or her daughter. So, you know, reporters here are being utterly disingenuous. If they wanted to have a single standard, a quote, let's call it a marriage penalty, well, let's apply it across the board. Every time a judge is a spouse and the spouse takes a position, we attribute the position to the judge and we ask the judge to step down from that case. But that's not happening here. They're singling out Clarence Thomas. They're applying a standard to him that they're not applying to other justices, and this makes the whole thing a transparent exercise in liberal activism. It's not going to work, nor should it.